Now, this actually brings up a point about speculation and speculators. Speculators seem to get a very bad press in the media. Right. Well, let's talk some about speculation. Now, in a very broad sense, speculation is just doing anything based on expectations of the future. And in that sense, we're all speculators. When I get in my car and turn the key, I fully expect that there is not a bomb inside the car. I wouldn't do that. Everything we do is speculative in that sense. But when we talk about speculators, we generally have something much more narrow in mind. And that is somebody that enters a market, buying it at what they think is a low price, and then trying to sell it at what they think is a high price, earning a profit by doing so. Right, so you buy the thing when it's cheap, you sell it when it's expensive. This leads to the question then, what does this do to markets? So here I have two markets laid side by side. On the left is the market right now. In the market right now, supply and demand are such that the price is very low. Whereas on the right is the market as we expect it to be sometime in the future, where for whatever reason the demand has increased while the supply has contracted, we end up with much higher prices. This is the kind of market that is going to attract speculators if they expect these to be the conditions. So just to make very clear why, here I've drawn lines over from the prices and these two points in time. It's very obvious the price right now is much, much lower than we expect the price to be in the future. So this is going to draw speculators in. But then we can think about the effect the speculators will have on the market. And what we should notice is that in the market right now, speculators will enter on the demand side. So we'll have new buyers, that is the number of buyers have increased in the market right now, leading to an increase in demand. So once we throw in the speculators, the price right now won't be quite so low as it used to be. This is normally when we start crying about speculators causing problems because they're driving prices up. And it is actually true if prices are relatively low, speculators entering the market will make those prices somewhat higher than they were before. However, that's not the end of the story. The speculators are not just trying to buy things cheap because they like cheap things. Remember, their goal is to sell when things are more expensive. So when we look into the future, speculators will enter on the supply side of the market. There'll be a new set of sellers that have entered, thereby increasing the supply, driving the price down at that point in time. So the end effect of speculators is that they take what would be a very large increase in prices over time and actually make it a substantially smaller price increase. That is, speculation actually leads to more stability, not instability in markets, as long as speculators are any good at what they do. Now, it is true, I'll let you draw out these graphs for yourself, if speculators enter at the wrong time, if say they buy high and sell low, they would increase in stability. That's certainly true. But in that case, the reality is they're going to pay for it themselves. When you buy high and sell low, you don't make a profit. You take significant losses. One final note that I want to make is that greed is a bad explanation for price changes. It's very common to hear somebody say something like, gas prices are so high because oil companies are greedy. That's why gas prices are going up. But this raises a rather significant question. How do we explain price drops? After all, we do know the price of gas does sometimes fall, and sometimes falls very fast. So how do we explain it if greed is what makes gas prices go up? Did oil companies just get overcome by these charitable impulses? They feel so bad for the poor consumers, they're cutting prices? Or did oil companies just forget to be greedy? You woke up one morning, the CEO of Exxon or whoever, it wakes up and is like, oh no, I forgot to be greedy. That was terrible. Or maybe they forgot how to be greedy. Here I thought I could be greedy by lowering prices. How silly of me. No, that's none of these are what happened. Right. The reality is that, sure, greed is a real thing, that is, profit is a real motivator for corporations and for also people working within corporations. Remember, corporations are not human-less. There are people that work for them, and it's people that are making these decisions. Right. The problem with greed is that it can actually push prices in either direction based on the circumstances. If I'm in an extremely competitive environment, it might actually be worthwhile for me to cut prices. Right. Because I want to produce more, I want to actually sell more, I have to lower my prices to attract consumers to do that. While at the same time, if conditions are right, it might make sense for me to produce somewhat less, which will lead to higher prices. So greed can go either direction. Any explanation that can push things both directions is something we should be doubtful about. And so it might be an underlying motivator, but it doesn't explain why prices are going up, nor does it explain why prices are going down. What we need to know is the circumstances that are driving prices, that are in effect, channeling greed in that direction. Also, to be fair, we shouldn't just talk about producers when it comes to greed. It's true, greedy producers would like high prices. But ideally, the price for anything, if the producer is firmly who's in control, the price for anything should be infinity. They just take everything anytime we try to buy anything and force us to borrow as much as we possibly can to pay for anything. The thing is that there's another side to the equation. It's not all about the supply side. The demand side matters too. And we have greedy customers. Right? As a consumer, I am very greedy. I don't want to pay any more than I absolutely have to for anything. For me, the ideal price for anything is zero. Give it to me for free. Right? So what it really comes down to in the market is balancing these two greeds. And it's supply and demand that tells us how these two greeds end up balanced to produce the prices we actually see. How is it that producers and customers come together to agree on prices that they both find to be mutually beneficial? Where I find it worthwhile as a consumer to go ahead and pay this price, and where producers find it absolutely worthwhile to them to accept the price in order to provide the good to me. All right, so greed is a bad explanation for price changes. Not saying it's not real, but it needs to be guided, and it is guided in the way that supply and demand describe.